Homework Hotline is supported in part by New York State United Teachers, working with parents and the community for our children's future. NYSET, a union of professionals, and by viewers like you.
Welcome to Homework Hotline. I'm Craig Zaremba.
And I am Laura Drake. Homework Hotline is a place where you can get help with your homework on the phone, online, or right here on TV.
And here's how it works. Teachers from Dial a Teacher are standing by right now to take your call and help you with your homework.
So if you would like help with your homework, call Dial a Teacher free at 1-888-986-2345.
You can also send us your questions on our website, homeworkhotline.org. Just click on the Act Back button and send in your question. All right, it's Tuesday, and that means it's time for our creature teaser.
That's a tough one.
It is.
All right, so this large animal can be found in warm waters around the world. It can be up to 8 feet long and weighs between 60 and 200 pounds. This creature sometimes causes problems for humans because it likes to visit bays, coral reefs, and shallow waters, usually by your favorite vacation beaches.
All right, this carnivore does like to jump out of the water, and though sometimes can be seen rotating in the air several times before splashing down into the water to strike its prey.
It's like a little bit of show off before it
exactly.
eats. Exactly. All right, if you think you can solve the creature teaser, give our hotline a call at 1-866-264-5904 or just answer it on our website, homeworkhotline.org. Answer correctly and you can have a chance to share the answer at the end of this very show.
And every correct response will be added to our Hotline Hall of Fame. Earn enough points and you can win a tablet at the end of the season.
Do you know the answer?
I do, but I'm not telling.
All right.
But we had to look it up.
All right, so we have our first caller. Hello?
Hello?
Hi, who's this? Hello?
Hi.
Who is this?
Danielle.
Hi, Danielle.
Danielle. Do you have a math problem for us?
Yes.
Okay, let me go on over to the board. What is your math problem?
X plus 3 squared. But the X plus 3 is in a parenthesis.
Okay.
And, I mean, cubed, and the cubed is outside of it.
Okay, so when we talk about a cube means it's going to be a little 3 up in the air, right?
Yes.
Danielle, what grade are you in?
12.
12th grade. Okay, so we have X plus 3 cubed, so I like that you use the words there. So when we go to do this problem, what does cubed mean?
It means you multiply everything 3 times.
By 3 times. So I'm going to tell you what not to do, okay? A lot of kids might say, oh, this is x to the third power plus 3 to the third power. And that is not what we do. Just like you said, we're going to have to multiply x plus 3 3 times, right? So what I like to do is I'm going to write it out. So it's x plus 3 times x plus 3 times x plus 3. How's that sound?
That sounds good.
Does it make sense?
Yeah.
Okay, great. So when we go to do this, we're going to have to take it in pieces. First thing we're going to have to do is we're going to multiply x plus 3 times x plus 3. And how do you go about multiplying binomials or polynomials?
You distribute.
You're going to distribute. So we're going to kind of do like a double distribute. We're going to distribute the x times everything, okay? Yeah. So let's do that first. What's x times x?
X squared.
X squared. And now we're going to distribute the x times the 3. So x times 3 is?
Plus
3x. So we're done with distributing the first x, but now we're going to want to distribute the 3 in there, right? So now we're going to distribute. I'm going to distribute on the bottom so we don't get confused. What's 3 times x?
3x.
And what's 3 times 3?
9.
9. Awesome. So when we multiply x plus 3 times x plus 3, we get x plus 3x plus 3x plus 9. Can we do anything to simplify that? That's kind of long. What can we combine to fix this out? Neaten it up a little bit.
3x and 3x.
Right. Which is what?
6x.
All right. So we need to fix this. So we had the x times x should have been an x squared. Let me fix that one. Danielle, you didn't catch me. I made a mistake. You're supposed to help me out. All right. So we have x squared plus 6x plus 9, and that's what this one is. But we're not done. What do we still need to multiply it by?
X plus 3.
So I'm going to bring down the x plus 3, the next x plus 3. And I'll go a little slower so I don't make a mistake this time. Okay, so now we're going to multiply these together, and we're going to do the distributive property again. It looks a little bit longer, but we got this, right?
Yeah.
So we're going to multiply the x squared times the x. What's x squared times x?
X to the third power.
X to the third power. And then what are we going to multiply the x squared by? What are we going to multiply this by next, do you think?
X times 6x.
We're going to take this x squared, and we still have to multiply this one out, right? So we multiplied it, we distributed it to the x, but now we want to distribute it all the way over to the? We're going to distribute all the way down to the end, which is the 3, right?
Okay. Yeah.
Okay. So we're going to do x squared times 3 is?
X squared times 3
yeah.
is 3x squared.
3x squared. Awesome. All right. I'm going to switch color again here just because it's fun. And we have the 6x here. So you see which guy we're distributing now, the 6x, and we're going to multiply it by everybody in the next parentheses, okay? So 6x times x?
Is 6x squared?
Yeah. 6x squared. You're right. Now we've got to remember there's 1x times 1 more x only makes it x squared, okay? And then we're going to do 6x times the last number over there, which is a 3. And what would you get for that?
9.
6 times 3. Remember, we got to multiply.
Oh, 6 times 3, 18.
18. And don't forget to bring on the little x. All right, 18. So now we just multiplied. We distributed the x squares. We distributed the 6 x's. Who else do we still have to distribute?
Don't you have to do the 3 times 9?
So we're doing, look here. So we did the x squared. We added the 6 x. We already distributed the x's. X squared, sorry, we distributed the 6x. So the last one we got to distribute is the
3x.
We're going to distribute the 9, and we're going to multiply the 9 times all the terms on the second half, okay?
Okay.
So what's 9 times x?
9x.
You're really good at multiplying these. What's 9 times 3?
27.
27. Okay. So it's colorful, but we've got a lot of terms here, and I think we can neaten this up. So who do you think we can combine together? So we're looking for the guys that are in the same exponent family. X squareds go together and X's go together. So who can we combine? Is there anybody who could put the X cubed with?
By himself.
Yeah, all alone. Wah, wah, wah. All right, and how about the X squares? Are there any X squares we can combine together?
6X squared and 3X squared.
Right, and what do you get?
Then you get 9x squared.
Perfect. Okay. Anybody we can combine with the x's?
9 and 18.
So 9 and 18 is?
27.
Yes. Don't forget to bring down that x. And how about that 27?
Plus 27.
Awesome. Great job multiplying all those polynomials together. Thank you for calling.
Thank you for having me.
Good night.
Good night. I said,
hey. Need help with your homework? Find the number for where you live and then make the call.
All right, that was a great question. Now, we need you guys to give us a call so we can help you. Until that, I'm going to go over and do a review problem from the 8th grade science exam. So come on with me. All right, I've been stressing that science is about vocabulary. So here is one of those ones that it kind of goes into knowing what the words mean. Now, here they give us a picture, and it says the diagram below represents two gases. All right, you got to know what the gases are. Being cycled through an ecosystem, letter X right here represents one of those gases. All right, and the other one they're telling you already in the question, so you already know that gas, and they need you to identify this gas. So here you have to understand what the process is that's going on. Something in the atmosphere is taken in by plants during photosynthesis, and then it's given off as a waste product, but that waste product is actually something that we desire, that we need for cellular respiration in plants and animals. All right. Now, when I go through this with my students, and this is actually kind of right where I'm at with my students now with the ecology, is this is photosynthesis and cellular respiration. And the kind of cool thing with this is they're interchangeable. So plants take in water. That's photosynthesis. They take in carbon dioxide. All right. They give off glucose, which is C6H12O6, and they make oxygen. So that's photosynthesis. We'll write photo here. All right. Now, if I flip the arrow around the other way, I have cellular respiration. So I'm taking in, if I do cellular here, cellular, I take in oxygen, I take in the glucose, I give out the carbon dioxide, and I give out the water vapor water. So now we got to look at what are the gases. So here's a gas here, and I'll change colors so we can see that. There's a gas there, and that's the oxygen that they're talking about right here. This is O2. So what's the other gas in here that we're talking about? So water is not really a gas here. There's carbon dioxide is our other gas, and here carbon dioxide is our other gas. So you have to understand that photosynthesis and cellular respiration work hand in hand, and they go back and forth in a big cycle. So this right here on our line, identify the gas would be CO2, or you could write it out as carbon dioxide. All right, so make sure you guys are studying and make sure you're working on that vocabulary and ask your teacher questions and give us a call so we can help you guys. Thanks a lot. I said,
hey, hey, hey. The order to solve a long division problem is divide, multiply, subtract, bring down. You can remember this order with a family: dad, mom, sister, brother.
All right, we're going to go back to the questions in a minute. Last week, we visited the Seneca Park Zoo to learn about the pied tamarin. This week, we're going to go back and learn about the golden tamarin. Check it out.
Golden lion tamarins are found in Brazil, northeast of Rio de Janeiro. There are approximately 17 different types of tamarins. They're primates. They're not monkeys. Their closest relatives, I believe, are marmosets. The golden lion tamarins, they range from 12 to 24 inches with the tail included. Their name comes from the large, almost like a mane around their face, kind of like a lion, and then their golden color. So you put those together and you get golden lion tamarin. They're diurnal animals, which means they're active during the day, and they're arboreal, which means that they live high up in the trees and very rarely come down. The enemies would be predators such as raptors, snakes, man. You know, just large predators in the jungle. They spend the majority of their time up in the trees. It's pretty dangerous for them to actually come down. That's where the majority of the predators are. They're mostly vegetarians. They eat mostly fruit, but they're also known to eat small lizards, snakes, bird eggs, insects. They actually have long, slender fingers and little claws instead of like normal primate fingernails. And they use those to climb and to dig into the bark and to find small insects. They actually live in small groups, up to about 14 individuals. There's usually a breeding pair, and then they usually live with their offspring. Golden lion tamarins are known for having twins the majority of the time, and then they stay with mom for the first couple of weeks, and then dad takes over a lot of the parenting duties, but then they switch back and forth for nursing. They have a very high-pitched, almost like a scream. It almost sounds like a bird. They have a few different little squeaks and kind of clicks, but the majority of it is like a loud scream, almost like an alert call to alert the other tamarins if there's danger around. They are endangered. There's roughly 1,000 golden lion tamarins left in the wild, and there's approximately 500 in zoos across the world.
Want to know more about this animal and others like it? Go to our website, homeworkhotline.org, and click on the videos.
All right, fantastic. Now, you have a review question you're going to do?
I do. I'm going to do an algebra review. So those of you guys who have the Regents next week, this is going to be a great question for you to look at.
Good to see.
So this question says, what is the result when 6x squared minus 13x plus 12 is subtracted from negative 3x squared plus 6x plus 7? And this is one that you're probably going to mess up because you see it right away. You go, oh, it's subtraction. I know how to do subtraction. And you're going to take this thing, and then you're going to take away the other number from it. But you really got to read carefully because what it says is subtracted from. And that's a big flag word for me. When I see subtracted from, that means that you need to know the first number. You have to have the first piece of it so that you can take something away from it. So what it means is to flip the order of it. So it's not going to be this first term this first polynomial minus the second polynomial, it's actually the second one comes first, and then you take the other one away from it. So what we're going to do is we're going to write this, this one is going to come first, because we're going to subtract this one from that one. So I have negative 3x squared plus 6x plus 7. And then the next part says that I have to subtract this one from it. Okay, so I'm going to write it down. I like to keep my polynomials in parentheses. I am going to take away the second term, which is 6x squared minus 13x plus 12. So now here's where it gets a little bit tricky. The reason you want to put in the parentheses is that you know you're taking all these terms away. If I didn't put the parentheses here, you might just see minus 6x squared, and you just think that's the only piece you're taking away. But I got to take away 6x squared. I have to take away a negative 13x, and I have to take away a 12. So whenever you take something away, you're really kind of adding the opposite. So what we're going to do on this is we're going to change all these to the opposite of what they are. And it's kind of like before we did the distributive property. This negative outside is really like the number negative 1, and it's distributed to all those terms. So I'm going to rewrite this piece here by making them all the opposite. So the opposite of 6x squared, or negative 1 times 6x squared, is negative 6x squared. The opposite of a negative 13 is a positive 13x, and the opposite of a positive 12 is a negative 12. And then I'm just going to erase this little part in the middle here, because I don't want to look at this part, because this is going to confuse me. I'm done with this part. Whoop, maybe not. So we're just going to cross it out, okay? So we're going to cross out this part. I don't need it anymore. That's old stuff. So on a paper, you may not have a smart board to do it either. So there. So now we take a look at this one. We now get to combine like terms, just like we did on the other problem. We're going to put all the x squares together. We're going to put the x's together. I'm not going to ask myself, am I adding or subtracting? I'm just combining terms, so that if it's a negative and a positive, we're going to think about the math that way. So when I look at this first one here, I've got a negative 3x squared and a negative 6x squared. So don't say, am I adding, am I subtracting? Doesn't matter. You have negative 3, gets together with the negative 6. You know that you're going to have negative 9x squared. Now we're going to do the x column here. The 6x plus 13x is a 19x. And then we have the 7, and we take away 12. We have a negative 5. So now we're going to go back and we're going to look at our choices and see which ones match. And when I look up here, hopefully we're hoping that our choice is up there. Yay! The choice is number 4. So just be careful lining up your like terms and making sure that you change everything after the subtraction sign.
I said, hey, hey. Here's a fun saying to help you remember the basic needs of the human body. Oh, can Venus flies make pretty webs? This actually helps you remember oxygen, carbohydrates, vitamins, fats, minerals, protein, water.
That was funny because you actually said you're telling you things not to do, which is a good thing because a lot of students do those things that we say not to do.
Right.
And reading was the biggest one right there. You had to subtract one from the other, and if you missed it, you would have had the wrong answer.
Yep, slow down.
Right. So I have an eighth grade question that we're going to go over, which deals with force and motion.
Oh.
All righty. So here, and I kind of apply this to what we're dealing with right now in the Northeast with bad weather and why it's important to wear a seatbelt. So when the question says, in a car accident, a seatbelt helps prevent injuries by applying a force. Now, why do we wear a seatbelt? Well, we wear a seatbelt because whatever car speed the car's traveling, you're traveling that same speed. By wearing a seatbelt, when that car stops suddenly, that seatbelt slows you down so that you don't accelerate or continue accelerating at the same rate that the car was going until it stopped. All right? So, what does the seatbelt help us prevent, or what's the force being applied here? Is it less than the force of the moving passenger? Well, no, it's not, because the passenger is going along at a certain rate, and the force of the seatbelt does not do that. A seatbelt helps prevent injuries by applying a force less than. It can't do that, because if it was less than, you'd continue moving in the forward direction. So it's not that choice. How about greater force than the force moving in the car? Well, if you're going along at 25 mile an hour and the seatbelt pulls you back at 50 mile an hour, you're actually going to go back through the back of the car, and that's not going to help us either. All right? In the same direction as the car's motion. So now if you're in the car and you're going along the road like this and the seatbelt's going in the same direction, it's really not doing anything for you because it's not going to slow you down if that car stops suddenly. All right, last one here, in the opposite direction of the passenger's motion. And that's exactly why you want to wear your seatbelt, so that it slows you down and keeps you from putting your head through the windshield or smacking your teeth on the dashboard or something bad like that. It's going to slow you down so that you're not traveling at the same rate of speed that the car's going. So our most correct answer is going to be that. All right, so I hope that helps you out. Give us a call so we can get you live here on TV. Thanks a lot.
I said, hey, hey.
FOIL, an acronym for the rule for multiplying two binomials horizontally. First, outer, inner, vast.
All right, I'm going to do another quick one on the board. I can't get enough of those polynomials.
That's good. Yes.
All right, so I'm going to come over to the board, and we're going to continue with the squaring problem. We did that problem that Danielle called up with the x plus 3 to the third power. We're going to take another problem, and we're going to do negative 2x, and we are going to add 6 to it. And then we're going to square this one. And so now when we square it, it means that you're multiplying it by itself. But I'm not going to do, Danielle was doing the distributive property, and that's a totally cool way to do it. There's a whole bunch of different ways. You can also do FOIL, but my favorite is to use an area model. So I'm going to do the area model today. So when you go to do the area model, I see that this is negative 2x plus 6 times negative 2x plus 6. So I get to draw a square. I just love to draw. And I'm going to put like two terms. I'm going to make it kind of look like a window. Some of my kids call it the window method. And up here, I'm going to put the negative 2x. I put the first term. And over here, I put the second term. So it's negative 2x plus 6. So I'm going to take this term. And now I'm going to multiply it by itself. So on this side, I'm going to break it up. And I'm going to do it here. Now, just a little connection of science. If you've ever done a Punnett square, it's a lot like that, like when you're doing genetics. So you'll be in great shape for when you get to living environment. So now we're going to do is we're just going to multiply each term. So we're going to multiply negative 2x times negative 2x. A negative 2 times a negative 2 is a positive 4. But now we got to remember that x times x is x squared. Now we're going to go to the next one. We have a negative 2x times 6. We just multiply the 6 times the negative 2. That's a negative 12. And then we're just going to bring the x over. Now we're going to come over here, and this should look familiar. Negative 2x times 6 is kind of the same thing we did over there. And we got a negative 12x. And then we're coming over to the last one, the 6 times 6, which is a positive 36. So that doesn't look like much of an answer. That just kind of looks like a big square with a bunch of numbers in it. So now what we have to do is we have to combine our like terms. So when I look here, just like we did with Danielle, and just like we did with the other problem, we're going to look for guys that are in the same family. So when I look here, I see a 4x squared, and there's no other x squares, so that's my first term. When I look at my next one, I see that I only have a negative 12 and another negative 12x, but they don't combine with anybody. So negative 12 and negative 12 is negative 24x. And then my last term here I have is a 36, and I'm going to put a plus sign in front of it to mark it down as a plus 36. So that's how you do it if you use the area model. The other way you could do it is you could do the distributive property like Danielle did, where we could have just multiplied them together, where she multiplied the two times each other like that. And then she would multiply the negative 2s twice and then the 6s twice. So two different strategies to solve the same problem. Good luck.
I said, hey, hey.
One way to remember the colors in the light spectrum is the name Roy G. Biv. Red, orange, yellow, green, blue, indigo, violet.
All right, we have a winner in tonight's creature teaser. Muhammad, are you out there?
Yes.
All right. What is this animal that we're talking about?
It's a black-tipped shark.
Oh, my God. I know. I was surprised it was a shark. Were you surprised?
Yes.
How'd you know it was a black-tipped shark?
Well, I heard of the name before.
Okay.
And then I didn't know much about it, so I decided to research a little bit on it.
Okay.
And then I found out all the clues that you guys were saying on the show, so I decided to give that a shot.
Yeah, nice. Nice job. So, like, it actually leaps up into the air and does, like, a little flip in the air before it eats its food. Have you ever seen anything like that?
Yeah, I heard of, like, the great white shark doing that a lot of times, so I thought maybe another shark can do it, if a great white can do it.
You sound like a shark fanatic. Is that, like, your favorite animal?
Yeah, I love animals, and my friends call me a zoologist because of all my knowledge of animals.
That is awesome. That is great.
Well, I'm going to call you next time I have a question about the creature teaser for sure, Muhammad.
Yeah, you got to make sure you call more often.
All right, I'll call more.
All right, congratulations. Don't forget, every correct response goes in our Homework Hotline Hall of Fame. Earn enough points and you can win a tablet at the end of the season.
That's all we have for tonight. We're saying goodbye. Vitality Teachers available with free homework help on the phone until 7 o'clock tonight.
Tomorrow on Homework Hotline, we'll continue our Move to Include series. Good night.
Good night.
Homework Hotline is supported in part by New York State United Teachers, working with parents and the community for our children's future. NYSET, a union of professionals, and by viewers like you.